Thank you. Amen. Thank you for that prelude. Good morning to everyone. We welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ to this service of worship to our great God. As I'm sure you've already noticed, Dr. Walker, our senior pastor, is not here this morning. He is fine, but he and his family are in quarantine awaiting a COVID test result for one of their children, so you are stuck with me preaching on a substitute basis this morning. Hopefully he'll be back soon. We hope he'll be able to be with us for the missions conference. I would just highlight a few announcements. One is you may have noticed some of these changes in our corona policies. Session made some decisions this week. The four items that are changed is that the hymnals are being returned to the pews, although we will continue to print the hymns in the bulletins. But having the hymnals in the pews allowed you to look at the words for some of the preludes and so forth. Ushers have begun to hand out the bulletins at the door instead of you picking them up yourself. For our next communion service, which is Holy Thursday, we will no longer be using the disposable elements, but we will be using the traditional elements, and we'll be having the congregation come up front to receive them that evening. And then you also notice that the ropes have been removed from the side sections. If you're at greater risk, the ropes are still in the middle section and in the balcony, but we've had so many people returning after being away from us for months that we're trying to make as much room as we can. And there's also the continued availability of the Reformation Room for overflow as well. We would just remind you of the Lenten services continuing this Wednesday evening at 6:45, and the church planting pastor of our Lebanon church plant, Francisco Victa, is going to be with us. Our Christmas offering went in part to support that work. Also, the new members class begins in 2 weeks from today, along with our new Sunday school quarter, which will be beginning, and if that class does not commit you to become a member of the church, but it's a 10-week class, if you'd like to know a lot more about our congregation, and you can sign up for that class using the Sunday School elective sheet that's available, or you can sign up on the website or on the app or just call the church office. But the thing that's before us this week is the missions conference coming up here in the next few days. You will receive a missions conference booklet on your way out, and that's a great resource to use throughout the week, throughout the year, to be praying for our missionaries whom we support. So pick up one of those on your way out. And of course, we have the mission fair on Saturday. And the missions committee wanted to make you aware of the policy that they've enacted for that missions fair. There are missionaries who will be there at their various stands who are at high risk for corona, and so they have some concern about interacting with a large crowd. So we ask that you wear your mask in interacting with those missionaries. It's not a worship service, so that we ask that you not use that conscious objection if you're interacting with them. Of course, you'll be able to take off your mask to eat the meal when you're seated. And the other missions announcements, just to highlight, is that tomorrow, March 1st, is the deadline for applications to these short-term missions trip, the LEAP missions trip and the Sacred Road missions trip. Both of the applications need to be in tomorrow. So if you're applying, please keep that in mind. I would just make one other announcement. Today is Pastor Keith Urban's final day on our staff. Although we're very glad that Keith and Becky will be remaining with us as active members of our congregation. You'll be getting a postcard in the mail inviting you to a retirement event here in our sanctuary for Keith and Becky that will be held on the afternoon of Saturday, March 27th. I might just mention that Keith began pastoring his first church 51 years ago. That's something, isn't it? We thank the Lord for the 14 years of gracious and loving shepherding that Keith has brought to our congregation and that many of you have experienced. I don't know if Becky's here. Is Becky still here? She was at the early service, but we do deeply thank Keith and Becky for their service among us. Let us then come to the Lord at this point in worship. If you're able to stand, let's join in singing the doxology. Thank you.
Our Father, indeed we praise your name for everything you are. It is our privilege, O Lord, to gather together. You sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus, who beckoned, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come and learn of me. For indeed, O Lord, you are not only the great teacher, but you, Lord, are the one who sacrificed your very life to save whoever believes in you. And this morning we would come, as your word tells us, and worship and bow down. We would kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Amen. Let us together confess our sins as our worship guide lays before us. Dear Father, you ask for my hands that you might use them for your purpose. I gave them for an hour, but then withdrew them, for the work was hard. You ask for my mouth to speak against evil and injustice. I gave it in a whisper, so I might not be accused. You ask for my life, that you might work through me. I gave a small part, in case I changed my mind. Lord, forgive my calculated efforts to serve you only when it is convenient, only in those places that seem safe, only with people who are not too different or broken. Though I am undeserving, cleanse me for Jesus' sake. Renew me as your own usable instrument as I bow before the cross. Amen. And these words of assurance from the Epistle of Titus. But when the goodness and loving kindness of our God, our Savior, appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, so that, being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Amen and glory to God. Let us read responsively in two confessions of faith, the Westminster and the Heidelberg Catechisms. What is God? God is a spirit, infinite, eternal, and unchangeable in his being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth. Are there more gods than one? There is only one, the living and true God. How many persons are there in the Godhead? There are three persons in the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. These three are one God, the same in substance and equal in power and glory. What do you believe concerning the Holy Spirit? First, that the Spirit with the Father and the Son is eternal God. Second, that the Spirit is given also to me so that through true faith he makes me share in Christ and all his benefits, comforts me, and will remain with me forever.
Joy and privilege this morning to receive as communicant members a number of young folks. Some of them were received at 8 a.m. These are folks who have been covenant children, what we call in Presbyterianism non-communicant members of the church because they have not yet publicly professed faith. And this morning they are doing that, and I'm going to ask our youth pastor, Matt Collins, to come as well to introduce them. Would you come and stand on the front step, those of you who are here? Come on down to the middle here so everyone can see you. Yeah. The balcony sight lines help there. Yes. That's great. Thanks.
All right. It is my great privilege to introduce you to our communicants class this year. We have Grant Mitchell, Kennedy Scotton, Isabel Heise, Liam Kiefer, and Corbin Walter. And before we continue, I just want to say how proud I am of each one of these students. They have put in a lot of hard work to get to this point. A lot of you may not realize that, but we have continued with our normal practice of putting them through a 12-week doctrinal class, if you will, in the fall. And then in the spring, they had a 5-week course with me to discuss their faith more practically and what that looks like and how they are to walk and live as Christians. So they have had to complete a workbook. They have memorized scripture. They have written testimonies of their faith. And they have sacrificed time to get to this point, thereby showing their sincerity and their love for this church and their love for Christ. And it's just been really encouraging for me to be a part of, and I hope it's encouraging to all of you to see them take this next step. And I would encourage you, if you have a moment after the service, to introduce yourselves to them and to take a moment to tell them how proud you are of them and encourage them as they continue on in their walk with the Lord. And with that, I'll turn it over to John.
Yes, they have professed their faith and given their testimonies to a group of pastors and elders already within small groups, and now they are publicly professing their faith as they respond to these questions that you are familiar with. They are the membership vows of our church, so I would ask the five of you to please respond to these five questions. Do you acknowledge yourselves to be sinners in the sight of God, justly deserving his displeasure and without hope, save in his sovereign mercy? Do you? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners? And do you receive and rest upon him alone for salvation as he is offered in the gospel? Do you?
I do.
Do you now resolve and promise in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as becomes the followers of Christ? Do you? Do you promise to support the church in its worship and work to the best of your ability? Do you? And finally, do you submit yourselves to the government and discipline of the church and promise to study its purity and peace? Do you? Thank you. And one of them, Kennedy, is receiving baptism this morning, so I'm going to ask her to step back on the carpet if she has room, and the rest of you to spread out a little bit from her. And Keith, maybe you could go up next to her. And would you kneel? If you can find room there, that's great. Kennedy is the daughter of Keith and Rachel, and she is being baptized on her profession of faith. And so, Kennedy, on the basis of your profession of faith and your desire to walk as a disciple of Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm going to ask Matt to lead us in prayer. You can rise.
Let's pray. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for the lives of each of these students. I thank you for their love for Jesus and their commitment to your people. I thank you that they have taken this next step in their faith, and I pray that you would bless them with your Holy Spirit. I pray that your Holy Spirit would continue to work in their hearts, to renew them in the image of Christ, and to grow them in holiness. Lord, use them in a powerful way, I pray, for the furtherance of your kingdom. May they be lights in a dark world for the furtherance of the gospel. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. You may go back. Thank you. Good job. Let us again go to God in prayer, and we'll conclude together with the Lord's Prayer. Father, we come humbly, and we come with intercession. We come asking for you to work in our lives that which is pleasing to you. We pray for the gospel of Jesus Christ to go forth to the nations of the world. And as we approach our missions conference this week, we pray that you would encourage us to support these efforts of our missionaries. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to be bound together with them by faith in our great God. We pray for safety for those who come to be with us. We pray for the interactions we have. We pray for a missionary mindset of our congregation. Thank you for enabling us to support missionaries around the world and in our own backyard. And Lord, we pray for this great end of the goal of you sending laborers into your harvest. We know that Jesus said the harvest fields are white. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of being co-workers with our God in telling the good news, telling the gospel story, and being your salt and light in the world. Father, we ask for each one of us in the places where you have put each one of us, in our families and neighborhoods and jobs and schools and homes. Lord, help us to bear witness to Jesus Christ in whatever way we can, with whatever weaknesses and limitations we have. Lord, thank you that you desire and ordain to glorify your name through your people, and that we are but jars of clay, and the all-surpassing greatness of the power is of God and not of us. So we pray that you would be with us, strengthen us, help us, as we seek to serve you in our community and, yes, throughout the world. May Jesus Christ be praised. We ask it through him who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This time in the service, we reflect on what God has given to us, and there are various ways to give, both online and in person. Think about the greatness and the grace of our Lord as we reflect and listen to the music. Thank you.
Thank you.
Turn with me to the book of Psalms. We're turning to Psalm 3. Psalm 3, the solo that Carolyn sang about when the shadows fall or when times are hard, when the road you walk is dark, aptly applies to the theme we're going to look at in this psalm. Listen to God's word as we read Psalm 3. O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying of my soul, there is no salvation for him in God. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory, and the lifter of my head. I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept. I woke again, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you strike all my enemies on the cheek. You break the teeth of the wicked. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing beyond your people. Amen. May God add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy word. This psalm is the first psalm in the Psalter after the two-part introduction to the Psalms in Psalms 1 and 2. Psalm 1 is about the Word of God, and Psalm 2 is about the Messiah of God. And then we have, beginning with Psalm 3, five psalms that speak a lot about trouble. They're called Psalms of Lament. We might say the Psalter begins with trouble and lament and ends in praise because the final five psalms all begin and end with the word and the call, Hallelujah, praise the Lord. We might say that this structure of the book of Psalms compares to the Christian's journey in this life. We begin in this life with the trials and troubles of this broken world, but we end in the new heavens and the new earth with joyous worship to God and every tear wiped away. What do we learn from Psalm 3 about bringing our sorrows and troubles to God? You could summarize the four points I'm going to make as we look at the four stanzas of this psalm in the words, lament, turn, trust, and ask. Lament, turn, trust, and ask. First of all, we look at lament. David expresses his lament to the Lord. He casts his care upon the Lord. Verses 1 and 2. O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying of my soul, there is no salvation for him in God. It is our lot in this life to experience trouble, and the psalm teaches us to bring the heartache and ache and lament of our hearts in the face of the troubles of this world, to bring these to God, which is not our natural response. Many of the psalms speak of this. Psalm 34, verse 19 says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Or Psalm 138, verse 7, though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. Or we think of Job chapter 5, verse 7, that very picturesque statement, man is born to trouble as the sparks fly upward. You can imagine sitting in front of the fire and see the sparks fly and think that's just an illustration of the troubles of life that fly into life. Think about David's trouble in this psalm. The title of this psalm is a psalm of David when he fled from Absalom, his son. The titles of the psalms are not part of the inerrant text, but they are very ancient, and it's likely that this is a true characterization of the setting of this psalm, when David fled from Absalom. 2 Samuel chapters 15 and 16 describes this very dark period of David's life when his own son, one of his sons, Absalom, came toward Jerusalem, raising a rebellion against David, his father. He had secretly conducted this conspiracy, and now was the unveiling point when it all went into action. And in the town of Hebron, a little south of Jerusalem, it was announced publicly that Absalom claimed to be king, and the trumpets were blown, and many of the populace went over to Absalom's side in this civil war. And we read in the book of 2 Samuel that Absalom had stolen the people's hearts, to use the verbiage there. Really, Absalom was a consummate politician who knew what to do in getting the populace on his side. And at this point, David and his associates have no option but to flee from Jerusalem. And so the description in 2 Samuel is very poignant, where David flees across the Kidron Valley outside of Jerusalem and over the Mount of Olives with this entourage of his military personnel who are supportive of him and some of his advisors and refugees that are going with him onto the road toward Jericho, this wilderness road, fleeing for their very lives. And in 2 Samuel 16, we see one of the things that happens on that road. Very interesting picture we're given, that as he goes along that road outside of Jerusalem, he's met by this man, Shimei. And Shimei is a Benjamite. You might know that that's the clan of King Saul, who is now dead. And he curses David as he stands by the side of the road. As David goes with his head covered in sorrow and barefoot, David grieving. And Shimei throws rocks at David and his warriors. Of course, the warriors all say to David, "Let us go take off his head." And David restrains them. He says, "No, it's the Lord. It's the Lord. Don't do anything." And Shimei, if you read the account there, says that this is happening to David because he's responsible for King Saul's death. Well, if you know your Old Testament history, you know that David twice spared Saul when it seemed that God had delivered him into David's hand. He refused, even though his men said, "Take his life." David refused to do so. So that was not the case. But still, it was difficult to have this enemy saying that God is against you, David. Verse 2, "Many are saying of my soul, there is no salvation for him in God," stating that God was judging David. He wasn't saying that God cannot help David. He was saying that God will not help him because he is judging him. A similar thing was said of Jesus Christ as he died on the cross for our sins. His enemies in Matthew 27 call out, taunting him and cursing him. "He trusts in God. Let God deliver him if he delights in him," implying that God didn't delight in him and that God wasn't going to deliver him. In a sense, David is the precursor and the foreshadowing of the greater king and the Messiah, Jesus Christ. We might say, as David lays his lament before the Lord, we might say, well, these are just words. But we all know that words are very powerful things. They go deeply into our hearts. They are one of the most deep ways you can attack someone. We might say that in many ways, words are more powerful than weapons. They discourage, they confuse, they can lead us to despair in some ways. When we think of that, we're reminded that Satan is the believer's great enemy, and Scripture portrays really one of his primary means of attack as being the accuser of the brethren, the accuser of Christians. He holds before us our sin and says, "How can you possibly lift your heart to God in prayer? How dare you? How can you ask God for help? You are not deserving. Look what you've done. Look at your sin. Look at your failings and weaknesses. You are not worthy." And in a sense, when Satan whispers those things in our ears and in our hearts, in one sense, we could say he is right when we think of what we deserve apart from Jesus our Lord and his righteousness. Apart from him, we would be in utter despair in the face of our sin and the accusations Satan would bring. But we have a Redeemer, and we have a covenant God who has loved us and set his mercy upon us in Jesus Christ. And because of Christ, Satan's accusations are fundamentally groundless. They are false. They are lies. Satan may run along the side of our road, so to speak, and throw stones at us and curse us. and declare that we are worthless, but as believers, we know that the Bible says our lives are hidden with Christ in God. What wonderful gospel truth we have to stand on. But it is not only Satan who brings us troubling words. Other people can do that as well. People may say very hard things to us, especially in times of heated conflict. They might say things that might be true, or it might be at least partly true, maybe things that are mostly false. And this can even be by the people who are closest to us in our lives. That's the way conflict tends to be in families and in marriages, or with close friends, or even with members of the church. A lot of the people who went over to Absalom's side were David's friends, some of his closest advisors. A whole host of his associates went over to Absalom, you know, weighing their political options. You try to back the winner, and it looks like Absalom was going to be the winner. It must have been a very disheartening thing for David to experience. The point of what we're seeing in this first, in verses 1 and 2, is that we have a great need to biblically lament. And that is not just keeping our troubles to ourselves and dwelling on them in an anxious and depressed way, but pouring out our lament to God. That's what the Psalms always do. Lament is oriented toward God. It's not simply in ourself. Whatever the source of our troubles, whatever the reasons they might be, or whatever the fallacies of someone like Shimei cursing David, we need to pour out our lament like David did. And for David, he knew that even though Saul's death couldn't be held to his account, he knew that God had told him that because of his sin with Bathsheba and Uriah, the sword would not depart from his household. And just think, he's seeing it unfold before his very eyes. And the fact that he was very responsible for this judgment being visited upon his household. Think of having to live with that. But my point is this, even knowing that, David does not hesitate to bring his lament, his burden to the Lord. There are some troubles that come into our lives that we have had nothing to do with, just part of the brokenness of this life. You could drive out of here today and someone could run a red light and you could be in an accident. There are some troubles that we are partly responsible for due to our decision-making, our sin, our lack of wisdom, maybe mishandling a relationship. But the point here that we see from David, no matter whether we are partly responsible or not, the scriptures tell us that God is still sovereign over every detail of our lives, over every trouble that comes our way. And just like David, we have the great privilege of bringing our lament to our faithful Savior and Lord. David poured out his lament. But secondly, David turns to the Lord. There's this turning. David expresses his confidence in the Lord in verses 3 and 4. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory, and the lifter of my head. I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. David turns from thinking and focusing on his enemies or on his own sin and failure and focuses on his God. Dr. James Montgomery Boyce says this about this text: when a believer gazes too long at his enemies, the force arrayed against him seems to grow in size until it appears to be overwhelming. But when he turns his thoughts to God, God is seen in his true, great stature, and the enemies shrink to manageable proportions. Isn't that a great idea? I think it's exhibited in a place like Numbers chapter 13, where there's this report from the 12 spies that the Israelites have sent into the promised land to spy it out and see what it was like, see what the people were like. And they return, and 10 of them have a very negative report. They say, we saw the Nephilim there, that people of great size and power. They were the descendants of Anak. And we seem like grasshoppers, they say. very despairing view of whether the Israelites would be able to conquer this land that the Lord was calling them into. And Caleb and Joshua, who give the minority report, these two men, their eyes are on the greatness of Yahweh, their God. And they say, "We should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it." Look at what David says about the Lord in verse 3. "But you, O Lord, are a shield about me." A shield stops arrows and sword blows of the enemy. "My glory and the lifter of my head." My glory is that word in the Old Testament that connotes heaviness, weightiness, substance. God is a God of great substance in that sense. His glory shows that. David's kingdom is being taken away from him, and he is losing his glory. But this verse is telling us that God is really his glory. David has all the glory he needs in the Lord himself. That is not an easy lesson for any of us to learn. And God is the one, we're told, who lifts up his head. Even when David is cast down and cast out, even when he's beset with this massive trouble that's come into his life, even then, God is still the lifter of his head, keeping him from utter despair. And David's confidence is recorded when he says in verse 4, "I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me," past tense. He knows it's so sure that God will answer according to his will that he puts it in the past tense. "He answered me from his holy hill." God is a prayer-hearing, prayer-answering God. For David, his confidence is rooted in his God. The great English pastor Charles Spurgeon said it this way, "We need not fear a frowning world while we rejoice in a prayer-hearing God." But don't we often have our eyes on the frowning world? David turned his lament to the Lord in this expectation of the Lord hearing. Our nation has experienced a difficult 12 months, hasn't it? And it's easy for all of us to focus too much on the news of the day and what seems to be a dark time. And dark times are very common in this world. God's people are always called in the midst of hard and dark times. After World War I, there was widespread casting away of belief in God in the West. The nations of the world had experienced the most disastrous war in the history of the world up to that point, with 16 million people killed in World War I, and killed for what many people after the fact thought seemed to be for no good reason, just nations warring. And the economies of the nations of Europe were in utter shambles. And in addition, at the end of the war in 1918 and 1919, the Spanish flu swept through the world, causing another 60 million deaths. Think of how much that was concerned of the proportion of the population of the world at that time. It was a time of great despair about many things, with the rampant rise of communism in many nations and fascism throughout the world. And in 1920, 2 years after the end of the war, C.S. Lewis, who at that time was still an atheist, he considered himself an atheist, and having experienced as an infantryman in the front line of the war the horrors and the dehumanization of trench warfare, and then coming back to Oxford and seeing the impact on the nation, this is what he wrote. He said, "I think we have now arrived at the point where a wise man can do more than wait for the end with what grace he can." Here was a disenchanted, despairing young man. And of course, for Lewis, at this point, the end was probably just a vague nothingness. A wise man can just do no more than wait for the end. Things were so dark. But in due time for Lewis, there would be a major turn, a turning to the Lord through the influence of the Bible and readings he was doing and through the influence of a few Christian friends who were involved in his life. Lewis and his lament would turn to joy in the Lord as he comes to Christ. In fact, years later, he would title the story of his conversion, surprised by joy. In our lament, we must turn to the Lord. But then number three, David expresses his trust in the Lord in verses 5 and 6. I lay down and slept. I awoke again, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Here we see faith in God. And traditionally, this psalm is termed a morning psalm because of verse 5. I lay down and slept. I woke again. And possibly, David penned this song after that first difficult dark night in which they had to flee across the Jordan in the evening or at night because word came that Absalom was going to be hard on their trail. And somehow, David got some sleep on the other side of the Jordan that night, and the Lord sustained him. Of course, this psalm isn't a guarantee that the Christian will never experience sleepless nights. Sadly, that's not the case. We will. But it is showing something of the fruit of confidence in God. And verse 6 further declares that confidence of faith in God, even in the midst of overwhelming trouble. Can you imagine this description? And it was very realistic for David. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Absalom was raising the military force of all 12 tribes to pursue David. That would be an overwhelming thought. Reminds me of Martin Luther after the beginnings of the Reformation as he was preaching and writing about the gospel. And he is called to a trial, to a hearing in the German city of Worms. And he is given safe passage. And he knows that 100 years before, John Huss was given safe passage to a similar trial, and that ended up with John Huss being burned at the stake. But Luther decides to go, and all of his friends tell him, Martin, don't go. It's too dangerous. And Luther's reply reminds me of David's statement here in the psalm. Luther says, even if there should be as many devils in Worms as tiles upon the housetops, still I would enter it. Might sound like presumptuous. It reminds me of the verse from A Mighty Fortress. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us. By the way, there was prudence in Martin Luther's plan as well, because he was declared a heretic and an outlaw, which meant that anyone could take his life on the government's behalf. But he had arrangements with Frederick III to whisk him off to the Wartburg, where he stayed for months in an incognito way. So there's certainly a line between faith and presumption, but are we trusting the Lord with the problems of our life? As we do so, as we trust in Him, our God works in our lives, even in the midst of trouble, to bring forth a degree of peace in the midst of turmoil and anxiety and stress, and to increase our faith in the midst of fears that we face, which are very real, and to give us renewed hope that keeps us from complete despair. God doesn't take away the waves of the stormy sea, but He enables us to look by faith to Him in the midst of the churning waves. He sustains us as we trust in Him. But finally, David asks. David makes his request to God in verses 7 and 8. Verse 7, arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you strike all my enemies on the cheek. You break the teeth of the wicked. The beginning of that verse is taken from Numbers chapter 10, when the nation of Israel is in the wilderness, and when they break camp, and the cloud of God would arise from over the ark and go before the people to lead them in their wilderness journey. When that would take place, Moses would cry, arise, O Lord, may your enemies be scattered, may your foes flee before you. No doubt David had that call in his mind. And David is very specifically asking God to deliver him from this trial as God's anointed king. David is the anointed king. Absalom is a usurper. If you're reading through the Psalm 2, just describes that the kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed. David is the anointed king. Absalom has joined the rebellious kings. And David, the anointed king, foreshadows the anointed king who is yet to come, Jesus Christ, the Messiah. And God delivers David. Absalom is eventually defeated, his army is defeated, Absalom is killed, and David is restored to the throne. And then verse 8 gives a declaration of God's deliverance, God's salvation. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing beyond your people. The great salvation of God is true for God's people, whatever happens in this life. Whether or not we see the answer that we might long for in this life, we know that the ultimate salvation of God will come if we are in Christ. And notice that in verse 8, David transitions from his own situation to apply this blessing and this deliverance to all of God's people. God's people in this life will certainly experience trouble. And again, they will enter into lament about the problems and trials of this life. But at the same time, God's blessing is upon them. As we've been studying in Ephesians 1, where we learn that we're blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms, that is a foundational truth that's always real for every person in Christ. Your petition to God in your situation might be for healing of some physical problem, or it might be for provision for your family or guidance in some major decision of your life. It may be for God to save your marriage or to bring reconciliation to a deeply broken relationship that grieves you. And we know that God promises to hear and answer prayer according to his all-wise purposes in his time, in his way, and we can't dictate to God. But do you see where this psalm has taken us? Whatever the problem, whatever our lament, whatever the trouble, we can say with verse 8, salvation belongs to the Lord. And that means that from beginning to end, God works in our lives by his grace to save us, to bring us to trust in Jesus, to keep us, to continue his good work he's begun in us, to ultimately glorify us when we see him face to face, and to finish that work he's begun in us. And so it reminds me of Romans chapter 8, that great chapter that asks, what can separate us from Christ's love? And the answer that Paul gives is nothing, nothing in heaven or on earth is able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Maybe you need to know the love of Christ by trusting in him, and you've never done that. You need to bow before God's anointed king, the one who came in humility but is going to come again in great power and glory. I urge you to believe the gospel and to give Jesus Christ your life. But for Christians, no matter how dire your world may look at this time, for God's people and for God's kingdom, we can live with steadfast hope, knowing that there is coming a day when God will bring his kingdom on earth fully and finally. Until then, things are going to be up and down, things are going to be dark more than they are bright. But one day, God will usher in the return of Jesus Christ, the new heavens and the new earth. And we know that then, lament will be no more. Amen. Father, we find ourselves very weak, easily distracted with the burdens of this life, caught up in both the cares and the pleasures of this world. Lord, give us new eyes to see the glory of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to trust in him. Yes, to rejoice when you bless us, to be thankful more readily, but also to be ready to pour out our lament to you in our deepest sorrows and heartaches. Teach us these things deep in our hearts, O Lord, and help us to believe your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Now may the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit, now and forevermore. Amen.